let's talk about the types of sensation seekers. The way a personality trait expresses itself can really vary from person to person. This is true for sensation seeking too. Sensation seekers are not all the same. Remember the four components of sensation seeking? Well, different amounts of these components can lead to very different kinds of sensation seekers. It's like a recipe for your own brand of sensation seeking. This means that high scores in sensation seeking can look very different from person to person. A high score could very well be the result of higher or lower scores in any of the individual components. Let's take a look at a couple of examples. These profiles are from people who filled out the sensation seeking survey online and agreed to share their story. Let's start with Mike. Total sensation seeking score is 19 out of 40. Thrill and adventure seeking is 5 out of 10. Experience seeking, 4 out of 10. Border susceptibility is 5 out of 10. Disinhibition, 5 out of 10. Here's how Mike describes himself. I love roller coasters and stuff like that. I thought it might be fun to learn to fly a plane, but when I start thinking about it, I get too scared to do it. Mike is typical of a lot of people. With an average scores for all four components of sensation seeking, he'll seek out interesting or thrilling activities as long as they're not too dangerous. Let's take a look at another profile. This is Aaron. Total sensation seeking score is 8 out of 40. That's pretty low. Thrill and adventure seeking is 2 out of 10. Experience seeking is 3 out of 10. Boredom susceptibility, 0 out of 10. And disinhibition, 3 out of 10. Aaron said, I kind of don't understand thrill seekers. I'm the kind of person who finds something interesting in everyday stuff. I can listen to the same music over and over again, and I love going to my favorite restaurants and ordering my favorite meal. They see me coming and get it ready. While Aaron may be generally curious, I wouldn't wait for him to volunteer to do anything remotely risky or dangerous. He's not going to go out of his way for something unusual. On the contrary, I would assume that he might avoid things that are too unusual or dangerous. His low scores for boredom susceptibility explains why he can eat the same thing over and over again and thoroughly enjoy it. Let's take a look at Rachel. Rachel's total sensation seeking score is 29. Now that's pretty high. But let's take a look at each of the components. She's got a thrill and adventure seeking score of 3 out of 10. Experience seeking is 8 out of 10. Disinhibition, 9 out of 10. And boredom susceptibility is 8 out of 10. Here's how she describes herself. I avoid all things that I feel are completely out of my control, but I love doing random and spontaneous things where I'm in charge. Hence, I hate flying commercially and I have a fear of flying. Now, I'm not too surprised. While Rachel's score is higher than average, her thrill and adventure seeking score is pretty low. With a score of only 3 out of 10, you aren't going to see Rachel doing dangerous things. Let's take a look at one last profile, Alex. Alex's total sensation seeking score is 35. Now that's pretty high too, but let's dive into each of the four components. Alex's thrill and adventure seeking score is 10 out of 10. Experience seeking is 9 out of 10. Disinhibition is 8 out of 10, and boredom susceptibility is 8 out of 10. Here's what Alex says about growing up. My family has described me as suffering from pathological wanderlust and always seeking adventure. When I was younger, they jokingly, sort of, tried to take away my National Geographic Adventurer and Travel magazines because they gave me bad ideas. When I'm sick in bed, I watch travel and adventure documentaries. I'm not very active on social media because I get bored sitting at my computer. It's not surprising that Alex might be described as having pathological wanderlust. All of the scores are pretty high, including those for thrill and adventure seeking. So he might take risks. His experience seeking might show itself as willing to travel, but he gets easily bored and is pretty disinhibited. I wouldn't be surprised if he might not get himself into trouble every now and then, which is probably why his family calls his wanderlust pathological. See, knowing a little about each of the individual components of sensation seeking can really help predict how that personality trait might show itself in an individual. High sensation seeking can mimic other psychological concepts too. When you think of a high sensation seeking person, it's really easy to just imagine them as extroverts, wild and out there. Is it possible that high sensation seeking is just extroversion? Before we get to the answer of that, let's look at the concept of introversion and extroversion. Now, some people think that introverts are shy and they keep to themselves, and extroverts are outgoing, but there's a lot more to it than that. The concept of introversion and extroversion also includes how people recharge. Introverts recharge by being to themselves, while extroverts tend to recharge by being around other people. One way to think about it is what you find more interesting, what's inside of your head or what's outside of your head. Introverts find what's going on inside to be much more interesting. That's why they can distract themselves with their own thoughts and will retreat there for comfort and to recharge. They can find others exhausting. Extroverts, on the other hand, prefer the outside of the world. They find others energizing and can get grumpy if they are alone way too much. Although it's really easy to imagine that these qualities relate directly to how much sensation seeking a person desires, low sensation seekers being introverts and high sensation seekers being extroverts, it's not quite that straightforward. Research has suggested that sensation seeking and extroversion are relatively independent. This means that there are completely different concepts and they can have a low sensation seeking extrovert or a high sensation seeking introvert. There are lots of thrill and adventure seeking activities that are relatively solitary, like rock climbing. In fact, I've met many introverted high sensation seekers, and I'm sure you have too. In the next section, we'll wrap up what we've learned about sensation seeking.